Welcome, everybody. Welcome to Jedi Disruption. These are conversations with leaders on emerging technologies and on science. My name is André Lezocourt-Pietri. I'm the director of Jedi, which is the joint European disruptive initiative. We are launching grand challenges to solve some of our society's greatest issues in healthcare, environment, digital, oceans, and space. And today we are absolutely delighted to have Olivier Ezrati with us. Olivier is a multi-talent. He's an author, he's a technology expert, he's a speaker, and he's also a board member of Jedi and a long-standing friend of the European DARPA. So, Olivier, first, thanks to be with us.
Hello.
And let's dive immediately into our topic of today, quantum. The French called it the revolution that France will not miss, which is pretty daring as a statement. Tell us about how France and maybe how Europe is faring in quantum.
Yeah, what's surprising with this statement is, I would add, government. French government shouldn't miss it. Because if you look at research in France and even at the way the startup ecosystem has been striving, France is in a very good shape. We have a very good scientist, particularly both senior scientists like Alain Aspect, who discovered the quantum entanglement back in 82. But we have also a lot of younger scientists who are now entrepreneurs, who launched very interesting startups like Candela, Alice and Bob, and Pascal. We have many, many talents around, and they didn't wait for the government. But now government is needed because we need more funding, we need more communication around a joint plan for the country, and to put that in the context of a European plan.
So Europe, is Europe a single market on quantum? And how do the different European countries, could you tell us a little bit about the different plans? Will we have, like in AI, a huge fragmentation? Or do you see a single quantum market emerging? And how do we compare to the US and China?
Well, you know, when you speak about a market, you have to make a difference between the offer and the demand. Right now, the quantum market is very small. It's just starting. There's already some fragmentation in the offering. What's important is to start to have a good offering that's European-wide. We don't have that many European companies right now in the quantum space. We have many startups around. Surprisingly, Europe is the largest continent with regards to the number of startups in quantum computing, which is not true for AI, for example. You have more quantum startups in Europe than in the US right now.
And how do you explain this?
The reason is the fragmentation of Europe. Because since there's a good fragmentation, country-based and also in research, you have a lot of startups coming out of research, and there are many, many initiatives everywhere in Europe, both in the hardware side and in the software side. So you have many, many startups in France, in Spain, in Germany. You have also a lot in the Netherlands. You have some in Austria, some in Italy. So many, many countries have their own startup ecosystem. Now the big challenge is to have these startups grow, get some nice funding, go to the good level of maturity for their technology, which may take some time. Many of the startups are still kind of private research labs compared to a regular imaging processing startup in the AI field.
I mean, we are talking, most of the people who are listening to us are scientists or technologists, but yeah. Let's maybe differentiate between the different fields. Obviously, there is sensors. We have quantum communication, which apparently also the Chinese are moving forward a lot. And there is the quantum computer, which is a bit the ground.
Yeah, that's the usual way. That's the usual way to split the market. But we have to add another one, which is quantum telecommunication.
Okay.
Quantum telecommunication is a broad segment where you put quantum cryptography, because quantum cryptography is one application of quantum telecommunication. But quantum telecommunication can go way beyond just cryptography. For example, quantum telecommunication can be the base for distributed quantum architecture, where you would connect different quantum computers through a quantum connection and make it look like if it was a big computer in a single location. So it's it doesn't work yet. There's a lot of work to do to work on the process of converting the status of the qubit, let's say a superconducting qubit or whatever cold atom or trapped ion qubit it is, to a photon, because you have to use photons to connect different computers through a telecommunication link. That's complicated. But when that works, it's going to be very powerful. Another example is, how do you connect a quantum sensor and a quantum computer directly through a quantum link so that you get the full data from the sensor? So those technologies are very, very intertwined. So you need to master all of them to create a good system.
So you would argue that the fundamental technological bricks will be the same for all the sectors? And can you tell us a bit about the frontiers?
It's not exactly the same technological barriers, but there are some connections. One example is photonics. Photonics is both one way to create qubits on top of atoms and electrons, because you have three kinds of qubits when you want to do quantum computing. It's either some kinds of electrons, there are many ways to control electrons, some kinds of atoms, you have cold atoms and trapped ions, so an ion is an atom without an electron, and you have photons. So you can create a quantum computer with photons. So you have a couple of very good startups in that space in the UK, Orca Computing and PsiQuantum, who raised more than $200 million, but had to go to the US to get this level of funding. And but on top of that, if you use photons, you can use it for cryptography, for telecommunication, for sensing. So some technologies have multiple usages. And sometimes you can't predict in advance what's going to happen and how fast you will master the technology. I can give you another example, which is called Datoms. There are companies in the US, or even so-called NV centers. NV centers is a technology using diamonds, where you use a defect in diamond to control some electrons in the defect. And with that, you can create either a qubit for calculus, or you create a sensor, or you can even create memory with that. A quantum memory. So some startups start to say, I'm going to create a quantum computer using NV Center. Since it doesn't work very well, they do a so-called pivot. They pivot and they move back to quantum sensing because it's easier to do. So sometimes you have a kind of reuse of the technology. So it's very hard to predict how it's going to go.
So you would say that today it's driven really by the offer? Or do you see some use cases emerging? And
Of course, you have many use cases in all the four dimensions of quantum technologies that we just mentioned. If you just take quantum computing, you have tons of applications, most of them in quantum simulation. So how do you simulate molecules? How do you simulate materials to create new batteries, new drugs, new whatsoever technology? So that's a way to simulate real life. In the quantum computing, you have a lot of optimization solutions, which can be useful for logistics, for transportation, for automated cars, for supply chains optimization, for banking, for marketing. All of those scenarios, people know about them. The only problem is we need the computers to do that. We have more scenarios than actual computers. So you need to make sure that we scale the technology of quantum computing to a point where all these use cases will be possible to implement. It will take some time. There is a branch of quantum computing and quantum software called hybrid algorithms, hybrid software, which is a way to merge existing quantum computers, which are not very powerful, and existing supercomputer, and make sure that both of them can do something useful. And that's an existing branch where a lot of companies are getting invested right now.
And has this already been applied, for example, in areas like climate simulation, which are the most calculated?
No, climate simulation is not the right use case. The reason is, first, it already works fairly well with traditional supercomputers. The second reason why it's not easy to implement in a quantum computer is it requires a lot of data. And surprisingly, there's a huge myth about quantum computing. A lot of people think that quantum computing is going to be an excellent solution to manage the big data, like we say, in machine learning and so on. It's not right. It's not right because putting a lot of data in a quantum computer is very costly. It takes a lot of time. Nobody knows how to do this very efficiently. Quantum computing is more efficient to solve a complicated problem with not a lot of data. So, for example, if you want to simulate a 1,000 atom molecule, you need to put in the data, let's say 1,000 information linked to the atoms you want to simulate. It's not as much data as if you wanted to train some deep learning solution to recognize 10,000 different images out of 100 million, where you would have billions of data. So most of the optimization problems that you can solve with quantum computing, at least as far as we know today, are modest in the data size, but complicated in the complication of the problem, the complexity of the problem.
Maybe a very specific question. As you know, one of our first grand challenges was to scan billions of molecules towards the COVID-19. So you mentioned that for protein or for a new compound simulation, that could be extremely applicable. Has it been applied in this current pandemic?
Well, it has been tried for very small molecules. So far, the big grail is a holy grail of quantum computing is to do protein folding, for example. But protein folding is a very complicated problem to solve, even with a quantum computer. So right now, what most people are doing is are using machine learning tools and deep learning tools, which are leveraging existing data of existing molecules that we know, where you know the 3D size and shape and form. And then we train a system to recognize based on what you know. But if you want to create ex nihilo, a new molecule, deep learning is not useful, not very useful. So there we will need to have a quantum solution. But to do protein folding, we will need a number of qubits that way beyond what we have today. So we don't do it right now. So if you ask IBM and Google and others, what they do right now is they are able to simulate molecules with about, I would say, less than 12 atoms. If you take one of the most complicated molecule in life, which is a ribosome, a ribosome is a molecule that creates proteins in your cells. It contains 300,000 atoms. So you will need a very large quantum computer to simulate that. So in between, we use a mix of techniques.
I'm sure this will be interesting for our partners folding at home. Because
but I know a company based in France called Qubit Pharma. Mm-hmm. Qubit Pharma has a goal to create tools for simulating molecules of any size, shape, and form, and to do also drug retargeting using quantum computer. But right now, what they do is they have their own algorithm, which is, by the way, open source, and they are able to run it on existing supercomputer and using GPUs, let's say the IBM Summit in the US or other supercomputings in Germany or in France or in Netherlands. And in the meantime, they're working on improving the algorithms and waiting for quantum computers to improve. And they will use a so-called hybrid algorithm. So a small part of the algorithm running on quantum computer and the big part running on a supercomputer.
How many qubits will we need to simulate the ribosome?
I have no idea, but I think it's good. It's probably in millions. And it depends on the way you count the qubits. There is a big argument and big discussion on what is a qubit in a quantum computer. Is right now, all the qubits we are using in the prototype quantum computers we have, even those from IBM and Google, they are so-called noisy qubits. So they produce a lot of noise, and this noise drives errors. If you take your own laptop, it creates errors, but very few errors. You have only one error out of, I don't know, billions of operations. So it's insignificant. But in quantum computing right now, you have a level of error which is about, let's say, 0.5%. And you have this level of error for each operation. So let's say you have 0.5% error and you do 20 operations. At the end, you have too much error and it doesn't make any sense. So if you want to have 1,000 operations, it's not possible right now. So what people try to do, they try to reduce the physical noise in the qubits, and it's a very complicated physical problem to solve because we are schizophrenic in quantum computing. We are schizophrenic because you limit the noise with limiting the interactions between the qubit and its environment. So if you isolate very well the qubit, it won't have too much noise. The problem is to do calculus, you need to control the qubit. So you need to have quantum gates which control the qubit. You need to have measurement which targets the qubit. And all this creates noise. So you have to find the right trade-off. And so one of the solutions that is devised by many scientists in that space is to create so-called logical qubits based on a big number of physical qubits and to implement so-called quantum error correction. So quantum error correction is an algorithm using also a physical layout of the qubit, which makes it so that the logical qubit comprising a lot of physical qubits has a lower error level than the its components. But it's still
the branch of quantum is the whole certification basically of quantum computers.
What do you mean certification?
I mean, you basically control the quality of what comes out of the calculation.
Well, to do that, you would need to have a large number of physical qubits, even with the existing quality that we have today. And scaling the number of qubits in a quantum computer is one of the biggest challenges. And those challenges are not just physics level challenges, it's engineering challenges. Let me give you an example. If you take the famous quantum computers from IBM and Google, they both have about 53 qubits available.
Those claim that they achieved quantum supremacy.
Yeah, they've done that last October. We could comment on that,
tell us more about it.
Later. So if you take those 53 qubits using qubits based on the superconducting technology, each of those qubits need at least 3 wires to get control. So you have a kind of chip, like a microprocessor from your own laptop. It's a chip, but it's controlled by 3 wires for each of the qubits. And the wires are sending microwaves. So you need to have a generation of microwaves with external microwave generator. And those microwave generators are either outside the cooled system, which is at a very low temperature of 15 millikelvin, or they are inside the cooled system, but then you need to make sure that they don't generate a lot of energy because they will create some heat and it will break the temperature of the system. So we have a very complicated electronics design to make sure that you control those microwaves in an efficient fashion with not dissipating too much heat and to scale. And right now, I've been studying that during the COVID lockdown. I found out that there were only a couple labs and a couple companies in the world who could do that. And one is in the US, by the way. But if you look at the way you cool the system, there are very interesting companies based in Europe. You have Blue Force in Finland. You have Qtra in Germany. You have Cryo Concept in France. You have a couple of companies who are very good at this. You have also very good research labs, particularly in Netherlands and in Grenoble in France, who know about the control electronics which can control efficiently all these qubits.
Where are these research centers coming from? I mean, this is obviously not dedicated to quantum. They come from...
You have both. Most of the research centers in Europe are coming out of universities or public research labs. If you take Germany, you have a lot of research labs everywhere. Jülich Center is famous for that. You have many, many elsewhere. In Netherlands, you have a big ecosystem around Delft, which created a lot of spin-offs, and they have QSoft and QTech, which are 2 spin-offs from Delft, which, by the way, are partnering with Microsoft and Intel, which is a kind of intermediate situation because... if European companies and European labs work only with American companies, it's not good for us. So we need to have better collaboration between European companies and European labs. That was the goal of the Quantum Flagship program.
Why did they go for Microsoft? I mean, without going into the details, there was no alternative for the software?
I don't know the history. I don't know the history in details. But what I know is American companies, they do their shopping in Europe. So IBM is shopping in Switzerland, because IBM has a very interesting research lab in Zurich. They are partnering with ETH Zurich to get some skills from the university. So they have joint investments in superconducting qubits. It was a way for the It was also a way for the research labs in Netherlands to get some funding. So since Intel put $50 million on the plate, I think 5 years ago, they said, okay. Otherwise, you have the big European flagship program. You probably heard about this. So one of the key flagship programs, it's a $1 billion investment, supposedly over, I don't know if it's 5 or 10 years. There was a first round and a second round of projects decided between 2018 and this year. They invested at least €160 million in 21-22 projects. And most countries are involved. There's a lot of leadership from Germany, from Netherlands, a little bit from France, a little bit from Switzerland in those projects. And they cover all the range of technology. So sensing, telecoms, cryptography, and computing.
I mean, there are so many applications, so many fields. Does it make sense to spray the efforts in all this? Maybe because of what you said at the beginning, the serendipity, you don't know exactly when the roadmap will hit. Or should we, I mean, is it the right way? What is your honest assessment of this research?
I think we should do it both ways. We need to spread investments in many different dimensions between, because we don't know who's going to be the winner. The specific aspect of quantum computing, particularly computing right now, is nobody knows who's going to be the winning qubit. And so we have to invest in many different types of qubits to be sure that we get the winner. If we make a too big bet on one, that's the loser. It's a losing bet. So we need that. But on top of that, we need to invest probably more than we do and more focused and more, with more collaboration. Hopefully, that's starting to take shape. I mean, the Quantum Flagship Program tries to do that in cold atoms, in quantum cryptography. There was even a project launched last March, which is coordinated by the team from Sera Leti in Grenoble, but it's coordinating research labs from throughout Europe on silicon qubits, which is one of the promising platforms. So we need to be both depth and breadth in the way we invest. And we need also to do something that we didn't do in AI, which is to be bold, ambitious. And one of the ways to be ambitious in quantum computing is to look at the market, to look at the applications, and make sure that we have a good ecosystem in software development, in algorithm creations, and to make sure that we do that in a way, a shape and form that's going to drive high volume markets. Because right now, and even when quantum computers will start to show up with a sufficient power, it's going to be a niche market at the beginning. And Europe must do better than winning a niche market, like we do in different places. I mean, in the industry, in the CAD/CAM, we are good, but we need to win a high volume market. So one of the ways to win a high volume market is to make sure we have enough people developing applications, developing software, and start right now, not wait for the big computer, and make sure that those people can be put in a position to invent high volume usages. And those volume usages are mostly right now in two different markets. One is healthcare and personalized healthcare, and the other one is transportation. And those are two fields where Europe is not bad. I mean, we could do something in those two spaces.
I mean, when we prepared a bit this discussion, you mentioned that there's a lot of focus on hardware, on the qubit, on the computer, etc. Let me push you a bit more. I mean, what are the frontiers? Is it the technological issue on the software side? Is it really, because you also mentioned that there are a lot of applications. So I don't see, where's the missing link here?
You mean between hardware and software, or in software?
In software.
Well, the missing link in Europe is, most of research in quantum computing was focused on the physics side of things. In the US and particularly in Canada, it was more balanced. And one of the reasons is in Europe, particularly in France, we are perfectionists. So we want to have the good computer, the perfect computer to do something. And so we wait for the good computer to be available, then we invest on software. In the US and particularly in Canada, they had a very different approach. One of the first company created in that space was called D-Wave. D-Wave is a startup created in Vancouver back in 99, so 21 years ago. And they did choose a very particular narrow niche of the quantum computing market. It's called quantum annealing. Most of the physicists say it's not quantum computing, so it's not a real quantum computer. But even if it's a fake quantum computer, it still more or less works. And there's a huge ecosystem that was created in the US and Canada around this company, like 1Qubit. It's one of the most famous software company in Canada. And so they developed a kind of beta test software publisher company around that. And though most of these companies now, they're trying to do software on the new quantum computer, which are using the more perfect way to do quantum computing. And so they can base what they do on the learning they had on the first generation. Europe and France, they want to have the perfect solution before launching stuff. So that's, it's a way to address the risk and address try and error differently. But hopefully it starts to change. I mentioned that in many European countries, you start to have new software startups being created. You also have a big challenge in education. You need to train a lot of engineers, a lot of scientists in algorithms creation and then on software development. We have hopefully some interesting works being done in Switzerland and elsewhere in Europe to develop new leading edge software development tools. Because to be efficient in software development, you need to have the right tools. And there's still a lot of work to do there.
I mean, that makes us very comfortable because, you know, JEDI has Switzerland completely on board.
Yep.
And a pragmatic approach to things. One of my last questions, but we'll definitely invite you again because we just touched the surface here. And I know you had a lot of other things to share with us. Privacy. I mean, obviously, it's a huge topic in Europe. We saw that with the tracing apps. We just saw the recent decision of the Court of Justice to consider the privacy shield not being actually protective enough for European data. Is quantum both a solution or a huge risk for one of our core values in Europe, privacy?
Well, quantum computing is potentially a huge risk because most of the specialists know that a big quantum computer would be able to break the public key systems, public key cryptography systems, like all those based on RSA key. Mm-hmm. It's true, but there are solutions coming from the quantum world. So there, you have both a quantum cryptography that's using light and fiber optics or satellite communication to protect communication. And you also have a new field that started to take shape about 10 years ago. That's called post-quantum cryptography or quantum-safe cryptography. It's a new way to encrypt data and to create some keys. And that's supposedly safe against quantum computers. So there are solutions. What's important is to put those solutions in place at the right time. So people have to invest right now their time and energy and funding on finding the right mix of quantum cryptography solution to make sure that they are quantum safe.
I mean, is this something where the Europeans could lead again? I mean, we saw in cyber...
They could with regards to standardization.
Okay.
Standardization is a complicated issue. I wouldn't say that we are in good shape right now, because what's happening is NIST in the US, the standard body in the US, they started a big RFP for creating the new PQC, so post-quantum cryptography standards. Many European countries did respond to the RFP. The equivalent in Europe is driven, as far as I know, by ETSI, the telecom standardization body. But it didn't drive and attract the same level of investment from the world. So it looks like the Americans may be in a position to control who are going to be the leading standards, even though they will use some IP from Europe. But you know what? The trick of the trade is what the NIST did is they asked the contributions from all the respondents to be open source and to be royalty free. So it's... It's a double sword edge. It's a complicated. I've not seen a lot of discussions between governments with regards to the positioning of the US in that space. It's becoming a political issue, I think.
No, absolutely. And the role of NIST, which is totally relatively unknown in Europe, is so critically and
strategically.
We see that again in quantum.
But I've looked at all the participation from European companies in the international standards body around the quantum cryptography. It was a shame. And we didn't have enough companies, enough labs. It was hijacked by the Americans and the Chinese. So we need to have more presence from European labs and large companies, and even the government bodies in those standardization bodies. You have ITU, you've got ISO, you've got many, many, many standards body where we need more presence.
And so we come back to the competence issue and the talent issue. I mean, we are probably one of the longest conversations so far. We tried to, but I think it was exciting for everybody. Let me finish on one question to you. Is there any technological aspect that we don't pay enough attention to in this quantum world? What would it be?
Oh, you mean in the world or in Europe? In Europe.
What are the areas that could potentially also be for us JEDI a possible challenge to launch? Where are the frontiers?
Well, with regards to JEDI, I would position the software challenge as a good way to address things. I don't think JEDI is positioned to help the physics side of things because it's very long term. It's a big investment. It's complicated organizations. Whereas we can drive innovation in software development, in algorithm development, in a more flexible way. So I would say that JEDI is more a software ploy than a hardware ploy in that space. But there's something else that could be done also is to make sure that people know each other. More companies know each other, know what they do. They can exchange on what are their trials, what are their skills development. Most of the large companies I know, I mean, whether it's Daimler in Germany or Bosch or Baths in France, you would have EDF, Thales, even though Thales is a bit different because they do quantum sensing, but Total or Airbus, all these companies, they have created small groups within the company with about 50 people investigating what they can do with quantum software, but they have to share more. They have to share the learnings. They have to also work with startups, work with labs. It's always the same story. I mean, make people connect, create serendipity between all those people. But I think that Europe is theoretically well positioned, because if you look at all the technology bricks in quantum, whatever, I mean, sensing, telecom, crypto, or computing, all the bricks are in Europe. I mean, Europe has all the bricks. You have cooling, you have electronics, you have the qubits, you have the physicists, you have the software people. Everything is there. The problem is it's scattered in many countries through small organizations, small budgets. There's some consolidation to do, probably not at the research level, but probably at the level of corporations and startups. I hope we will have some merging M&As in the startup scene. I would dream to have international startups based out of Europe with skills from Netherlands, Germany, France, Switzerland, Austria, whatever. It would be a nice evolution. You know, my lesson of history is we have Dassault System, we have SAP, two leaders, two worldwide leaders in their own field. It shows up that it's possible to create a leader. So let's dream about it.
Wonderful. On these very positive words, let me thank you very much. It has been a fascinating discussion. We'll definitely invite you again that you tell us more about cryptography and the future quantum computer. Olivier Zrati, thank you very much. It was exciting.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.